Penguin Random House Audio presents Robert B. Parker's Old Black Magic by Ace Atkins. Read for you by Joe Mantegna. Chapter 1. I'm dying, Spencer, the man said. I nodded, not knowing what else to say. An early summer rain beaded down my office window, dark gray skies hovering over Berkeley and Boylston as afternoon commuters jockeyed for position out of the city. Their taillights cast a red glow on slick streets. Somewhere a prowl car hit a siren, heading off to another crime. The man sitting before me smiled and nodded, his hands withered and liver-spotted. His name was Locke.
"How long have we known each other?" Locke said.
"A long time."
"But oddly, never worked together."
"Our work as investigators seldom crossed paths," I said. "Different peepholes."
"Recovering stolen art isn't really your thing."
"I've done it," I said, "once or twice."
"You're familiar with the theft at the Winthrop?"
"Of course," I said. "It made all the papers, on TV. Biggest theft in Boston history."
"Biggest art theft ever," he said. "Next year will mark 20 years. I've chased those paintings most of that time, traveling from Dorchester to Denmark with not so much as an inkling of where they ended up. It's beyond frustrating. Maddening, really. And now, well, with things the way they are..."
"One was a Picasso?"
"That was the least valuable of the three," he said. "Picasso, Goya. But the prize of the Winthrop was also stolen. The El Greco. The Gentleman in Black. Are you familiar with the painting?"
"Some," I said. "I recall seeing it years ago, when I was young."
"When we were both young," Locke said.
He smiled and reached into his double-breasted suit jacket and pulled out a slick photocopy of a very serious-looking dude with a pointy black beard. The man wore a high-necked lacy shirt and a heavy black cloak. His eyes were very black and humorless. "He looks like a guy who used to kick field goals for the Detroit Lions," I said. "Benny Ricardo."
"The subject is reputed to be Juan de Silva y Ribera, third Marquis of Montemayor and the warden of the Alcázar of Toledo."
"Oh," I said, "him."
"El Greco painted him in 1597, he said, "well before the pilgrims set foot in America. Long regarded as unimportant by the Romantics, El Greco found new appreciation and fame among the Impressionists and Surrealists. Picasso, in particular, was a great admirer of El Greco. You see the distorted length of the man's neck, the off-kilter perspective?"
"Some have noted my own perspective as off-kilter," I said.
"Although I admit to having more of an affinity for the Dutch masters." "I spotted your Vermeer prints when I walked in," he said. "You also have many fans at the Hammond. You helped recover, what was it? Lady with a Finch."
I nodded and offered him something to drink. It was that time of the day when I could bend to either whiskey or coffee. Locke, being a man of the arts, approved of the whiskey. I pulled out a bottle of Bushmills Black, gifted to me by Martin Quirk, and found two clean coffee mugs left to dry upside down beside the sink.
"Without being trite, that painting you recovered from the Hammond is nothing but a Rembrandt footnote," he said. "This work is something altogether different, a cornerstone of Spanish and art history."
"How much?"
"One can't always put a price on the priceless," he said, "but somewhere in the neighborhood of 60 or 70 million.
Like any serious art connoisseur, I gave a low whistle.
"I wanted to recover the piece myself," he said, "but now I have to understand the realities of my situation."
"I'm very sorry."
"And I'm sorry to march into your office with such maudlin conversation," Locke said. "But my doctor told me to get my affairs in order, whatever the hell that means. I figured this was the first order. Have someone to pass along my files, endless notes, and potential leads. I grew too old for this case 2 years ago. The Winthrop continues to push with the anniversary coming up next week and these letters arriving every other week.
Letters?
Yes, Locke said, sipping the whiskey. Not really ransom notes, but from someone who claims to have knowledge of the theft.
Do you think they're real?
Perhaps, Locke said. The letters were very specific about details of the theft. The writer was also aware of an arcane detail of the painting. El Greco himself had written on the back of the canvas in his native Greek.
Have they asked for money?
No, Locke said. No demands have been made, and no means of communication has been offered. The letters have been addressed to the museum's director, Marjorie Ward Phillips. Have you and Susan ever met Marjorie at a fundraiser?
I shook my head and picked up the coffee mug. The mug advertised Kane's Donuts in Saugus, a place I consider to have made many fine works of art.
Marjorie is a determined, if altogether unpleasant person, Locke said. Her staff calls her Large Marge.
A big personality?
How do I put this, he said. She has an ass the size of a steer and the disposition of a recently castrated bull.
Lovely, I said. Can't wait to meet her.
Oh, she'll charm you, Locke said, chuckling. At first. There will be martinis and long talks of art's value to the city of Boston, but don't ever disagree with her or challenge her in front of the board. Once that's done, you will be visited by the hatred of a thousand suns.
If you're trying to talk me into this, I said, you're failing miserably.
You must take this case, Spencer, Locke said. You must. If not, they've threatened to offer the contract to this British investigator, a young man from London who, recent successes aside, has all the earmarks of a four-flusher.
At the moment, I'm working two separate cases, I said.
Did I mention the $5 million reward, plus covering your daily rate and all expenses?
I smiled and turned over my hands, offering my palms.
Perhaps I could find time to meet with Large Marge. I know you're joking, he said, but for God's sake, don't let her ever hear you say that.
Hatred of a thousand suns?
And then some.
Locke smiled, straightening in his chair, and buttoned the top button of his jacket. Both eyes stared at me, one slightly off and one roaming my face with deep sadness and intelligence. His face sagged, his blue eyes drained of much color in life.
It might be months, he said, but probably weeks. I have a driver. He's waiting for me downstairs now.
May I help you out?
First, he said, will you accept an old man's dying wish?
Damn, Locke, I said. You do go for a hard sell.
I don't have time to mince words, he said. I really think they're onto something now, and the last thing the museum needs is an amateur, unfamiliar to Boston, skulking about. This other detective is of the worst sort. He's trying to charm the board into letting him take the case, but they need someone who understands thuggery and violence well beyond red velvet walls.
I should add that to my business card.
Locke laughed and reached for the Irish whiskey. He drained it quickly and replaced the mug on my desk.
Why did you stay on this long if you felt like it was hopeless?
Locke smiled. There's something almost mystical about this painting, he said. Believe me, you'll see. Maybe a way of touching the past. We are all just passing through this world. We'll be gone soon enough. But this painting has remained for more than 500 years. Perhaps recovering it would have been my shot at immortality.
I nodded. I refilled our glasses.
To immortality.
We sat and drank the rest of the whiskey in silence. After a bit, he stood, shook my hand, and without a word, walked out the door.
Chapter 2
Large Marge, Susan said. Do you know her?
I've met Marjorie Ward Phillips from the Winthrop, she said, but I've never heard her called that horrible name. Susan and I stood at my kitchen island in my Navy Yard condo as I stirred a fork in my cast-iron skillet simmering with kale, onions, and hickory-smoked bacon. The sprawling brick building had once been a dockside warehouse with big picture windows looking onto the harbor and across to Boston. Pearls snuggled in a ball.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.